So, thank you very much, everyone, for coming. This is the second session, and I'm really, really happy to have Mael here. Mael, besides being by now an old friend, we have shared accommodations in San Sebastian, San Paulo, and several places at various conferences. And I think it's really hard to present Mael because it's when you're talking about doing interdisciplinary research, I think is the one who gets closer to the definition. Is a mathematician, theoretical biologist, a philosopher, and works on many different tables at the same time. It's really a big pleasure to have him here. The publication, like, if I had to give an account of the publication, I will have to give a talk myself about that, so I'm not going to do it. But I'm just going to mention a very nice book with Giuseppe Longo, who's also a very interesting polymath on organisms. A paper with Matteo Mossio, who's been here a couple of years ago, on the Journal of Theoretical Biology that I've been talking to Stuart Kaufman during the summer school a couple of years ago, and he was absolutely raving about that paper. And actually in the first or second page of this new book is raved. The last book by Stuart Kaufman opens up with him saying, well, these two guys are awesome, they understood everything, we should do that. And another paper with Kaufman and Giuseppe Longo on enablement and entailment that I like personally like very much. So, but without further ado, please, you have the floor.
Thank you. So today, what I'm planning to do is to give a bit of an overview of what I'm working on with respect to theoretical biology. Which is why I call the talk some strategic perspective, because theoretical biology is not really a field, doesn't really exist institutionally. There are a few journals, but no real departments and so on. But I will give my own spin to what it means to do theoretical biology, and in a sense it's relevant, it's questions that are relevant also for physics. So let's start. I am currently editing a special issue in a new journal called Philosophy World Democracy on what I called the dusk of theoretical controversies in current sciences. My point is that theory as such is declining in most sciences. So for biology, I argue about it myself, but I lean on physicists and mathematicians for the physics side. And so that's the topic of the special issue. And there are reasons that are both internal to sciences and external, external ones are, for example, the reorganization of academia, which can be seen as a disorganization. For example, Peter Higgs in physics said to a journal, I think it was The Guardian, that he would not have been fit in current academia. So that's why this reorganization is a disorganization, in a sense. There is also a sharp priority on technological developments, and it is the case especially in biology. With the development of omics technique, but without a sound theoretical background for them. There is also the reductionism that comes with it, that is to say, for example, in physics, Jean-Marc Lévy-Leblond said that the scientific revolution came with a speculative side to it and a technological side to it, and the two things interfaced, and that was the scientific revolution. But today, the speculative side is declining, and in a sense, there is a lot of subcontracting of theorization to philosophers, which is a problem because philosophers have also their own stakes, purposes, and so on. So that's a bit the overall situation. Specifically in this special issue, I argued that what is dominating, so especially in biology, is something that could be called computational empiricism. It's not a doctrine by itself, it's more an episteme, that is to say, computational empiricism aims to describe what most scientists would say is science, is scientific research. So it's not a doctrine that is set in stone somewhere. So it's, in a sense, it's more what I'm doing in the paper is more an attempt to describe what scientists consider as science nowadays. And this computational empiricism, it's so strange, it's inconsistent, highly inconsistent. It's a strange amalgam between a form of empiricism and more specifically of induction-based reasoning. And it's actually inscribed in the structure, in the very structure of scientific articles. And the structure is called IMRAD for introduction, methods, results, and discussion. So the idea is to go from a neutral view on observation towards more qualitative results, so it's an inductive structure. At the same time, in experimental biology, for example, statistical tests are always used to tell whether results are significant or not, that is to say whether they come from chance alone or not. And the statistical tests are built on a kind of empiricism, that is to say the falsification of a null hypothesis, but it's a computational one, so it's not a real empiricism. Of course, there is a sharp contradiction between the two things, an inductive structure and some Popperian structure where hypotheses come first. So it's a mess to write a scientific paper, because I wrote also a few empirical papers, so I know that firsthand too, and it's a headache to put your thought straight in this kind of mold. And last, I will say that nowadays there is also a kind of computationalism that is contrasts the idea that science will lean on logic, with logical empiricism, or mathematics, which is a long tradition in physics, and by which I mean effective modelization, that is to say modelization that you can run on a computer. And with the idea also that something that you could compute with a computer has more value than a mathematical model where you can derive theorems. So it's a bit of an overview, but the point is that in all of this, what is systematically neglected are work that aim to synthesize observation, synthesize ideas, possibly synthesizing them by bringing a new view on things. So for example, Einstein's special relativity is a way to address facts and theories, by shaping them in a new way. But it's, in a sense, it's synthetic. And it has an epistemological aspect to it, the principle of relativity, which is about reference frame and the idea that there is ultimately no center to the universe and so on. So I'm not dwelling on that, but those work are systematically neglected. The only part in the scientific literature that systematically do a bit of that are the review articles. They aim to synthesize mostly facts, sometimes a bit of ideas, but without being considered original research, which brings me back to my point, that is to say theory is neglected. And the overall result is that, so now I will talk more specifically about biology, is that the previous frameworks, such as the one of molecular biology with its central dogma and so on, are in a sense damaged by the observations that they enabled, and the contradictions accumulate without new perspectives shaping things theoretically differently. So it's a situation where the biological discourse is weakened and highly inconsistent. For example, to give an example that is current, let's say, in the case of vaccine, overall the discourse is that you present an antigen, and then there is a response because the thing is foreign to the body, and then you have an acquired immune response. That's the classical theory. The thing is that it's insufficient. And actually, you need to put, here I'm talking about classical vaccines, you need to put something that is, je me souviens plus en anglais, un irritant. Something that that bugs the body in a sense. And an adjuvant. And the anti-vax, so I'm not talking about COVID, but the classical anti-vax, they're puzzled or they're built on these adjuvants that are required because the antigen by itself is not sufficient to trigger an immune response. So there is a weakness in the theory. There are some alternatives to that, to the mainstream theory, but they are not good enough, let's say. So the anti-vax built on the weaknesses of theories and the inconsistencies that build up in this case in immunology, and that's just one part of the problem, of the overall problem. So there is a lack of theorization, especially in biology and especially when studying basically life cycles. There is a bit more in evolution, even though there are also huge contradictions in evolution. So what I mean specifically by theory is something that is very different, for example, from mathematical modeling. Because mathematical modeling is about looking at a specific situation. For example, you look at the Earth and the Sun, and you build a model of the solar system. That's a model. A theory is more at the level of universal gravitation, but though it doesn't need to be universal in general. So it's a different way to reason, and as I said, the characteristic of theory is to aim to be synthetic, so to bring together a whole lot of considerations, both empirical, mathematical, epistemological, philosophical, coming from interfaces with other fields. For example, the interface between biology and physics or biology and chemistry is very relevant. And sometimes applications also can be significant for the way you want to develop a theory. For example, it's not the same thing to approach biological systems in order to, let's say, sell drugs, which is what pharmaceutical industry lean on, even though some try to have a new model because it doesn't work well. Whereas trying to theorize in biology in order to take care, let's say, of ecosystems, of living humans, and so on. It's a different approach or starting point. And last, I give a specific role to mathematics. It comes, in physics, theorization comes with mathematics since Galileo and Newton. In biology, it's not the case. For example, Darwin doesn't use much mathematics, even though there are some mathematical reasonings that are critical for Darwin's rational. So for me, the role of mathematics is somewhat optional. And if there is a role of mathematics, it also needs to be sought again when we are talking about biology, that's for sure. And it will be the case also for social sciences. So let's now dig in the matter of the theorization of biological organizations. And what I'm going to do is to introduce some ideas that I think are strategic for building a theory of organisms. So in biology, there is a theory of evolution with its shortcomings, but there are some debates, but they lack a bit of efficacy. For example, the alternatives to the modern synthesis, which is the dominant view in evolution, is called an extended synthesis, but it builds on the same concept. So it's just an addendum to the classical theory. It's not really a new one. But I won't focus on that. I will focus on organisms themselves. So, at the level of organisms, molecular biology has focused on molecules and molecular interactions as explanants. And what is noteworthy is that this view is more reductionist than reductionism itself. In Cartesian reductionism, you decompose your objects, you understand the parts, and then you put them together, and then you understand the whole, let's say, the machine or whatever. In molecular biology, you decompose, you look at interacting parts, a few interacting parts, and then you say you understood. So it's not a genuine reductionism, it's a reductionism of molecular biology. But as a result, there is no theory of biological organization that you could have maybe, I don't think it would work, but you could have maybe addressed it from a reductionist viewpoint, but then you have to be serious about it. If you decompose, you recompose. And then when you recompose, you fall back on something that would be like an organization. But since this work has not been done, there is no such theory of biological organization, so that's one thing that I'm trying to contribute to. But now, methodologically, I think it's critical to address the relationship between what could be a theory of organisms and physics. So, this relationship, this interface between physics and biology can take multiple forms. One are, let's say, a very concrete interface, for example, when there is motion inside an organism, for example, cells that move, or inside or outside, you need forces from the point of view of classical mechanics. So that's a very concrete interface. Second, come analogies between models. So for example, statistical physicists work on systems that are not their classical systems. They work, for example, on schools of fishes, flocks of birds, and things like that. And it's sometimes it's let's say not presented in a very compelling way theoretically. That is to say, they claim that it's just physics, whereas they take as elementary units birds or fishes, which are somewhat different from molecules and have more complex behaviors. So and moreover, they come from a naturalist theory. So, analogies like that can be very useful because it enables fast modelization of biological situation, but they need to be criticized systematically, I think. And last, comes something that is more at the level of what I'm talking about, it is to say the comparison of how you build a theory. So it's at the same time methodological and epistemological. And with that comes the question of mathematics, the role that is given to mathematics and how its use is justified theoretically. And in this way to theorize and to build models too, the main problem, I think, with respect to biology is that physics understands changes on the basis of invariants. So invariant mathematical structures, equations that do not change, but describe how change will take place. More specifically, physics understands primarily changes as a motion in a predetermined space. And this space and this motion are structured by symmetries and invariants. And this is not very convenient for biology because here Darwinian evolution theory poses the primacy of history for the understanding of living things. So it's variation in a sense that comes first. And so I do it very, very fast, but then the point is that we should not organize our theory in biology like physicists do, because we don't have the means for that, and the means will be invariants and symmetries. A small remark is that in physics, the way to conceive The objects is based on what is called and with Giuseppe Longo called generic objects. That is to say, for example, when you define the length unit, so the meter, you use the speed of a light ray in the vacuum, and it's a light ray. Any kind of light ray will do. So the way to define objects is really generic, and it's supposed to apply to many things at the same time. And reciprocally, in a sense, to do the mathematics, you have to be able to consider a whole lot of situations as somewhat equivalent. So for example, when something is falling in free fall, you're using generic mass, a mass m, let's say, position x, and so on. So you're not stipulating specific situation. And the idea is that the whole of the free fall can be subsumed with, for example, one equation, or a couple equations, or whatever, few equations. So without the specification of each individual situation, that will be anyway uncountable, and so on. So you have to work with this kind of generic objects. And these generic objects are typically ahistorical and are also decontextualizable. That is to say, you can remove them from their context, and the light ray can be anywhere in the vacuum that you want, for example. And that comes from the mathematical writing, actually, because if you think you can capture what is happening causally in a system on a sheet of paper, in a sense, that means that you can really decontextualize your object by abstracting it. So it's deep in the structure of how physicists reason, and it's a deep problem for biology. So the point is that if we take historicity seriously in biology, then we should not consider object as generic, and we have to work with something that we have called specific objects. And with that comes the rethinking of the role of mathematics. So to begin a little bit on that, the idea is then to state that variation and historicity come first in biology, something that we have called the principle of variation, and that stability comes second. The point is not that there is no stability, but stability comes second. And we have called stable elements, so the elements that are stable, for example, for a time and for a given set of organisms, we call them constraints. And the point is that they have a causal role. But then the stability of these constraints has to be explained, because it's ultimately contingent, so the relative stability has to be explained. Well, it is postulated in physics, for example, the stability of the, it's an old term, but the physical laws, or you could say the fundamental symmetries, for example, they are postulated, so they need not an explanation. Maybe I will skip that. So there are two explanations of stability in biology, and they are complementary, and maybe there could be others. But it's interesting to read things under these starting points. One is natural selection. Natural selection by itself is not about the emergence of something new. Here I'm just talking about the principle itself. It's about, as Darwin puts it, the preservation of favored races. So you have first a variation, and then natural selection preserves some of this variation. It doesn't generate novelty by itself. So natural selection can be seen as something that justifies that some things are conserved over time. And the second justification for stability is what we call in the organicist tradition organization, that is to say the mutual maintenance of the parts of an organism. So way to do the short history of that is, for example, Kant, And in modern times, Rosen, Varela with topoiesis, Kaufman, and the paper that you mentioned with Matteo Moscio, which is really in this tradition. And well, I will go fast on that, but these two ways to discuss stability in biology, to justify it, are also two ways, two philosophical ways to interpret biological functions. There is an etiological interpretation of biological functions as something is functional when it has been selected due to its effects. And something is functional from the organizational viewpoint when it is in an organization, so that it maintains something, maintains itself, so that it's here due to its consequences in a sense. So that's two interpretation of function. I think it's interesting to have that in mind. And here we also have an interface with the principles of physics, that is to say, biological systems are far from equilibrium systems. It's interesting to say that in Belgium because Prigogine is not too far, was not too far. And biological systems, biological organisms, have to last far from equilibrium. But it's not just that they are just far from equilibrium, they're also in a non-spontaneous configuration far from equilibrium. And then this need for a justification for how things last over time in biology really makes sense from the perspective of physics, but go beyond physics because of historicity. Well, I'll skip that, but that's just a schematic of the closure of constraints, so how constraints can mutually maintain each other by acting on processes of transformation. And the point here is the circularity of the drawing. So now if we sum things up, what do we have with this very short sketch of what a theory of organisms could be? We have constraints, and that's the thing that is the most classical in a sense, because it's closer to physics, it can be used to do mathematics, mathematical model and so on, in a traditional sense. But at the same time, these constraints are part or are related to something that we call specific objects, that is to say, objects that cannot be defined just by constraints, that is to say, by causal relationships. Instead, they are determined at the same time by historicity, context, and random events. Now, I will give three more specific leads on how to move forward once we have these schemata in mind. So the first one, I didn't present that. The first one is the question of measurement. I will define more specifically what that means. The second is how to work with this kind of changes that are not the same kind of changes, let's say, that take place in physics, that is to say that are subsumed by invariants and symmetries. And last one is a way to write or to precise the schemata to do some kind of formal work, but in a new sense of the word. So the first thing that I will discuss, and it's the longest discussion here, is the question of measurement. And I take measurement in a very precise way, because the question of measurement is very broad. Here I'm taking it in a restrictive sense, the sense of the structure of the theories. And the idea is that in physics, at the level of theoretical principles, there is a definition of how observation and theoretical description are related. I'll give two examples. The first one is in classical mechanics. The idea in classical mechanics is that the state of a system is a point in the possibility space, in the free space. But this point cannot be measured with infinite precision, can only be measured with limited precision, and this leads to the notion of deterministic chaos or deterministic unpredictability, because even if you have a very narrow, very precise measurement, trajectories can diverge very far, very fast. Donc, it's related to the principles in the sense that it comes from the measurement, the unpredictability. The second one that maybe you probably all know a little bit is a question of the quantum measurement. Yeah, it's different. In a sense, you could say that it comes from the articulation of a macroscopic object. At the end of the day, it's the person that it measures and a microscopic object, the quantum system. And in this case, the measurement is more structured, it's more complicated, it can yield different results with probabilities, and most importantly, it changes the state of the object. When you measure, you always can change the state of an object. So that's two kinds of theoretical notion of measurement that comes from physics. And in biology, there is no such notion, which is a probable reason why is that molecular biologists could focus on discrete structures, like, for example, the sequences of DNA and so on. So there is a lot of mathematics to discuss whether the right sequence is obtained in a specific device and so on. But in principle, a discrete structure, you can measure it exactly. It's not like a continuous position. For example, if there is a text here, you can read it exactly, the structure of the text. You can recover each letter. What is neglected here is the rest of the biological system, that is to say the organism. And the point is that the organism has to be addressed when measuring biological system. But I will come back to that. From a more theoretical perspective, what is going on is that in physics we have these invariants, these symmetries, these equations, and the outcome of this situation is that measurement only need to address quantities. At the end of the day, the experimental physicist obtain quantities about his system, and ultimately it's the state of the object that is defined, so as a position in a possibility space. In biology, since the constraints change, since the nature of the object changes over time, the measurement has to address quantities, true, like in physics, but also changes of constraints, changes of relationship between constraints, and also the uncertainty that results from that. So this uncertainty is something that is very practical. For example, back to the COVID vaccines, or more generally in clinical trials, the challenge always is that you are testing a drug on a small sample of the situation, and you know that the rest of the population will have qualitatively different features. Not the whole rest of the population, but some people in the rest of the population will have qualitatively different features and will possibly exhibit side effects or lack of potency or whatever. So that's something that is known. There are some processes that are organized on the basis of this knowledge, but it's not really theorized as such. So that's, in a sense, the aim of this part of my talk, to give a glimpse of how it can be theorized. So, as I said, the point is that the measurement does not refer only to a part, it must accommodate organization in their context. If you have this schemata of how biological objects work. And the physics-like measurement, let's say, is only about the observable constraints here on top. And so if you only go with this concept, then you are neglecting all what is below. And so to address this part of what is below, that is to say the specific object, I've introduced the notion of symmetrization. So symmetrization would be to make equivalent objects that are not genuinely equivalent. And that can be made on the basis of their history, so their past, on the basis of their context, and also on the observation of some properties. And well, it can be very concrete in a sense by transforming the objects, or it can be only at the level of the description of the object. So it can be both concrete or theoretical. So let's give some more practical aspect to this notion of symmetrization. Even biophysicists would tend to claim that biology is ultimately physics. When they are doing experiments, let's say on chicken development, they have to talk about chicken. So the trick that I always pull in debates, public debates, is to ask them what chicken is. And usually they don't have an answer for that, because the answer to this question, at least in the current state of science, doesn't fit at all with the epistemology of physics. The answer comes from systematics, the way to classify living beings, and the main method in systematics is to classify living beings on the basis of their historical origin. So not at all like physics do for subatomic particles, for example, not at all on the basis of the relationship between objects, how they interact, and so on. So systematics name biological objects on the basis of their historical origin, and it's really a completely different epistemology from the one of physics, and it's still a rigorous way to work, with its shortcomings too, of course, but it's still a rigorous way to work. What is interesting is that to do this classification, it's mandatory to have a specific concrete objects as a reference point. So for example, the names in the systematics, so for example for Rattus norvegicus, corresponds to a specific sample called a type that is kept in a university or in one of the various museums of national history. And that's very different from physics. Again, I took the example of the speed of light. To measure the units of physics, you refer to theoretical situations first, and then you can instantiate them in, for example, le mètre étalon or whatever, so in specific objects. But if the specific object is destroyed, so be it, let's build another one, and it should work, because ultimately the definition of these units come from theoretical invariants. Whereas in biology, the definition of the names come from a specific object, a concrete object. So it's a very different architecture, theoretical architecture. And it's a way to build on the historical aspect of biological objects, and without making the huge jump to say that it could be reduced to a more physics-like approach by invariant symmetries, equations, and so on. So, well, I will go fast on that, but my point is not just to lean on systematics in concrete experiments with strains and so on, or with cell lines. Actually, biologists use a lot of tricks or methods to control not what the object does, but the fact that they come from a single controlled origin. So for example, when having a clonal population of cells, to do experiments on them, freezing them to stop time and prevent variation, and so on. So those are all tricks that enable to control both the origin, the fact that it's relatively recent, and so on. That's again an illustration of that. That's all mice strains that are used in laboratories. So that's all the same species. And the point is that this part on the right, it's just the top here of group 4. So you have a gazillion of strains. The point is that even in laboratory conditions and in animal farms, biological objects never stop to change. And these changes impact the results of experiments. So if you want to repeat the experiment, to reproduce them, you need to control as much as you can the historical origin of objects. So the point is that it's not something that is discussed at the theoretical level usually, this historical definition of the concrete object you're working with in experiments, because most modelers come from physics, but it's something that has been built on in experimental practice. And actually, there is no other way to do things, at least not for a long time. So the point is that these different strains can have dramatic consequences. So for example, in rats, DMBA, which is basically a chemical, can lead to 0% of tumors among the rats to 90% of tumors among the rats, depending on the strain that is used. Similarly, endocrine disruptors can have various effects on the strains, notably because some strains are selected to be prolific. Being prolific is something that has to do with the hormone system. So those differences in strains can ultimately have consequences for regulations against carcinogen or endocrine disruptors. So it's not benign. I will just take 2 points from this slide. Something really to have in mind is that to repeat an experiment, so to redo a measurement in a sense, in biology, you really need to work on two objects that have a material connection, a genealogical material connection. It's not the same at all than in physics, where you can work on objects that you can generate completely de novo, like light rays, for example. So that's something really fundamental, and that has a challenge for theorization. The second point is that in this context, you can see the situation as leading to different measurement strategies. One strategy, for example, is to aim or to strive to do to get closer to physics. So, for example, aiming to have basically to repeat experiments on organizations that are as close as possible to each other. That's to say, having a very strict symmetrization, as strict as possible. So, for example, when working on a clonal population of cells, when restricting to a very narrow strain of rats and so on, those are all strategies to try to make the object as similar as possible, provided that they are never exactly the same, and there is always a diversity that is generated at each generation with development and so on. So that's one strategy, but the strength of this strategy is that sometimes it leads to more reproducible results. Not always. The shortcoming is that it leads to results that are very specific to these organizations. So for example, there has been a huge debate for nociception in mice, because the mice that have been used are specifically have a very specific way to address pain and so on. So the results are highly specific, and when, for example, working in pharmacology and aiming to do drugs for humans, having results for a very, very, very specific strain of mouse or rats is not really does not really correspond to the overarching aim. So it's interesting now to see all these different strategies in a continuum, in a situation where anyway, you have to address this historicity of biological objects and history as a way to define biological objects. I don't know how much time I have.
10 minutes, but you could take 20 if you want.
Okay. I will go fast on this part because I would like to skip to the next section. Another challenge, very quickly, is to work with the notion of new possibility. It's a notion that, in a sense, comes from philosophy. I'm thinking especially about Bergson. And has been reused or reinvented by several theoretical biologists, including Stuart Kaufman, and independently by Francis Bailly and Giuseppe Longo, and then I worked on it too. And the idea is that there is some specific things to address if we want to make a scientific concept out of the notion of new possibility. Because the possibility space in physics can very well change. It's not a problem. If you take the gas in this room, there is some gas, some molecules that come from outside and so on. So the dimension of the space that you use to represent the gas in this room fluctuates. That's not a problem because it's more of the same. The problem in the new possibilities in biology is that it's these new possibilities correspond, in my view, to things that are qualitatively different and typically new functions. So my point is that the concept of new possibility has to be specified in this way, and also to address some possible contradictions. But what is interesting is that having this idea in mind that basically all mathematical structures that you use in biology correspond to ultimately to constraints that can change over time, it can also lead to new techniques to lead to specific or new kinds of prediction. These new techniques, I call them deconstructing models. The idea is that if you have mathematical structures that you use to describe part of an organism, then you can always look at alternatives at the level of these structures and see if they are met empirically. So a very simple example, the mammary glands here on rats is typically described as a tree, as a mathematical tree, which is an acyclic and connected graph. And what is interesting is then you put the negation of each of the hypotheses describing a tree, and you investigate whether it is met empirically. So for example, acyclic, well, the opposite is having a loop. So there is one here, and there is one actually in a fair part of the samples that I have. So connected, well, a part that will be disconnected, so it's not the right word here. And there is one here actually, and it's my own empirical discovery, even though it's not published as such, but because people didn't think that it could be possible that a part would be disconnected. So here is basically also a close-up of this disconnected part. So it's really epithelium, and it's it doesn't seem to be an artifact of any kind. And then, when you have a graph, it's an object that is made out of nodes and edges, and there is two negations of that. One is the existence of things that could be connection or could not, possibly. For example, when there is ducts that touch but without merging, so the lumen do not merge but the duct touch. So it's an ambiguous thing, but the most important one, and it's not in the picture, is the case of the tumor. In this case, you really do no longer have a node on the edges, you don't no longer have ducts and so on. But so the point is that a very simple case, very simple mathematical structure, that is not properly a model because there is no causation here, it's just a structure. But just looking at the negation of the hypothesis that construct this mathematical structure leads to possible predictions that can be tested empirically. And here I will go very fast on this, but it's a recent paper that we did with Matteo, where we introduced in the schematics for closure a new symbol precisely to accommodate what I was talking about for the measurement, that is to say aspects of an organism that are only defined by historicity, past context, and so on. That is to say the elements of the object that are not defined by constraints, by causal relations, but that are defined by the past, typically, past and context. And the idea is that this symbol, so written chi, is a very very strange beast in the sense that it's not really a formal construct like mathematical constructs and so on. I call it a symbol because it refers to a concrete object. I told you for the classification, for example, that it was always by reference to a specific concrete specimen kept in a very specific location and so on. So this symbol is a symbol precisely in this sense that to make sense, it has to refer to specific objects. And then one aim is to use it to enable constraints of closure to address more of the historical aspects of biological objects on one side. But another aim is also to describe more specifically how biologists do their experiments, because the way they do their experiments, which is takes planning over several generations of mice, not of humans, for example, are manipulation of the chi aspect and only of a few constraints, that is to say, checking weight, health, and so on of the animals. So it's mostly by manipulating chi over time that the experiments are defined. I skip that and I just say a few words on another project that is a kind of application of everything that I've said, and at the same time it's a very current application. So this project aims to theorize the notion of disruption in biology. The word disruption is used a bit everywhere. It's used in ecology, for example, for plant pollinator networks. It's used in physiology since the 90s for endocrine disruptors, physiology and development. It actually gains more and more weight in the scientific literature. So here it's in ecology. And the point is that it's not theorized as such. There is the notion of perturbation in ecology. That is not always just the one in physics, because perturbation in physics corresponds to very specific mathematical techniques. There is no specification of the difference, for example, between perturbation in the sense of physics and disruption. Whereas the use seems rather specific. So part of my project is to make this use more explicit, to distinguish, for example, perturbation and disruption. And at the same time, to develop new mathematical models or new theoretical insights to address this disruption under the assumption that there is some aspects that are common to all of these disruptions. So the overall assumption is that making this notion of disruption more precise will require something like a theory of organization, and that is more specifically at the same time addressing systemic aspects or organizational in the case of organisms, and at the same time historical aspects pertaining to evolution or possibly to development. And once you take historicity seriously, you are really no longer in the epistemology of physics. So then you would have a concept of disruption that is really different from perturbation in the physics sense. Perturbation in the physics sense is really you have something that is at equilibrium or stable, you disturb it a little bit, and then you analyze what this little perturbation does. So one interesting example, and I think after this example I will stop.
It's perfect.
One example is in ecology. I took it as a flagship example because it's the simplest one actually. So in ecology, there is a study of phenology. Phenology are activities that are seasonal. So for example, flowers that bloom in spring and insects that hatch at the same season. The point is that the climate change transforms this phenology. And if this transformation was the same or roughly the same for all species in an ecosystem, then it will not change interactions, right? Everything will take place a bit earlier, possibly a bit longer, but it will not change interactions. The thing is that empirically, the way this change takes place is very random, as you can see. For plants, it's a bit more uniform, that's to say more plants are active earlier in the year, but for pollinators, yeah, it's quite random. And there is a reason for that, that is somewhat clear. It's that different species use different clues to start their activity in the year. So some use the photoperiod, which does not change with climate change. Some use the temperature of air, of soil, and so on. So all of those change differently. Some use the snow cover. And on top of that, plants tend to have some kind of memory from one year to the next. So basically, it's a mess. And the result of this mess is that the different species are desynchronized. And since they are desynchronized, some species are in trouble. So for example, initially, you had a pollinator that had some plants to pollinate during its whole activity period. And after a change, here you have two periods where he has nothing to pollinate. So, according to Memot and colleagues, but it's a whole field of research really, this will lead to 17 to 50% of pollinators in a specific ecosystem to disappear. But what is interesting here is to go towards to investigate the structure of the measurement. Here, what matters is that the initial configuration, so to the left here, is very specific with respect to activity periods. In a sense, it is highly improbable because for every pollinator and every plant in an ecosystem to be in a viable situation is very unlikely. Then, this specificity has a systemic meaning. The meaning is that all population in the ecosystem are viable here through their interactions. It's to say the pollinators feed on the plants reproduce things to the pollinators. So it's an improbable situation that has a systemic meaning. Viability. And then what happens with the disruption is that this specific configuration is becoming more random, more generic in a sense, and as a result it is becoming less viable. So it's the point here is to have a specific kind of reasoning that builds on historicity, that builds on systemic reasoning, but that is distinct from physics, because historicity is the key argument to explain how the specific configuration that was viable initially came about. In physics, it's really if you have to give specific initial conditions or specific value of the parameters to explain something, then you are in trouble. It's not something that is allowed. You have to work with generic values of the parameters or otherwise have proper justification. So here the proper justification is the historicity of the system and the idea that ecosystems build themselves over time, so it's, it comes from viable situation to viable situation that complexified, etc. So you have a short schematic of what could be a theoretical notion of disruption in this situation that is the simplest one.
that is to say, history and coevolution lead to a situation that is very specific, very unlikely. Of course, it's
And that corresponds to a situation of viability through the property of the system.
And with the disruption, you have a more random situation with a loss of viability.
So I will skip on this, but when I said improbable here, it's something like 2 power 1 over 10 power 500, if I remember well. So those are the random configurations that you can get, and viability of all species would be the zero that is on the top left. Yeah. Let's skip that. That's just, I will mention another case, which is a case of endocrine disruptor. So here the schematic is a bit more complicated. Because you have to introduce the developmental time into the picture. But what is going on with endocrine disruptors is that so one part of the organism, which is the hormone system, regulates the development and is becoming more random due to these chemicals that alter its effects. And as a result, development is altered and there is a loss of functionality. So a good example of that is diethyl bestriol, DES, which is a chemical that was given to pregnant women as a drug and leads, for example, to malformation of the uterus. It's called a T-shaped uterus. And there is basically no space for baby to grow. So you have ectopic pregnancy, typically, so the baby grows outside of the uterus, which is extremely dangerous. But you can also have typically cancers, the tissues are a bit disorganized and so on. And that's what I mean by random. It's not random in the sense of quantum randomness or whatever. It's becoming more generic, so it's it corresponds very well to Boltzmann scheme, for example. I didn't develop that, but it's becoming more generic with respect to an initial specific situation. And last, because I don't want to skip this part, is that so what I've talked about for now for disruption is what could be called first order disruption, but there are also second order disruption. So first order disruption is, in a sense, losing a part of what history brought to organisms, to their ability to live and so on. Second order disruption is the loss of their capacity to produce new possibilities, so to bring novelties that contribute to their variability. And a good example of that is the disruption of the contribution of evolution by natural selection to viability by habitat fragmentation. So what happens is that I said that the elementary notion of evolution by natural selection is only about conservation, but if you take dynamics, then it can contribute to the emergence of novelties. But for that, there is a need of having a genetic diversity. You need a diverse population, and then this population can respond with different fitness to a given context and so on. The point is that with habitat fragmentation, so you can have a huge population that does not collapse, but that is cut in small parts where gene flows are no longer possible, between which gene flows are no longer possible, and then each of these parts evolves as an independent unit. And the thing is that with a small population, genetic drift take over and there is a spontaneous uniformization of the population, then no longer diversity, and then natural selection can no longer play any kind of positive role in evolution. So it's really the disruption of the capacity of a living being to produce functional novelties here through evolution by natural selection. But there is another case which is interesting, is that in so here at the interface with psychology, is that in the relationship between parents and their baby, there is a very interactive relationship where the parent accommodates the emotions of the baby to create kind of pseudo-narratives that prepare language, that prepare real narratives later on. So here I'm talking about very young babies, less than 1 year old, for example. And so this improvisation of the parents is critical for the emergence of language afterwards, and the emergence of narratives afterwards. And when smartphones or tablets are used to display movies, even to display little songs, to use little songs and so on, this interactive part is no longer here because the program or the videos do not accommodate the state of the child at a specific moment. So there is a disruption of this interaction. And the fact is that the overuse of digital media for very young children is frowned upon by pediatricians. And it leads to language retardation, difficulty in attention, and difficulty in relationship with other people. So that's another disruption. It is more at this dynamic level. I will stop here. Thank you for your attention.
Please.
Thank you for your talk. I have a very general question. You said it was very different from physics. Especially because we cannot find in biology symmetries and invariants. And intuitively I agree, but I wonder if the argument will apply to all fields of biology the same way. For instance, if you are considering spices evolution, or maybe cells of microbiology, mm-hmm. or climate, it seems to be different framework, at least for me. As a non-expert in biology. And so I wonder if we can see biology as an umbrella of theories in which we will find different strategies, or does it make sense to consider biology as a limited science and with the common grounding for an epistemology? I just wonder. And specifically the argument with symmetries and invariants, maybe it will be applied differently microbiology and spices,
I would say what enables to put all of biology, but in a sense also human sciences, here is the notion that historicity is central. So if you start from that, then it's a commonality between all fields of biology. But it is also the case, let's say, for economics. So this part of the analysis is very generic. Then, for example, the notion of organization, it's primarily for organisms. So that will work for cells too, but for ecosystems, it's something that is under discussion in the literature. But some aspects. Really, some aspects of my talks are very generic, precisely because I'm working on the architecture of the theory and how you construct theory and how you can use mathematics or what difficulties there is in using mathematics. But other more specifically constructive parts, like for example the classification of living beings. That's for species, for organisms. For ecosystems, it would work differently. But the problem is that I've not worked on how to solve it, and I don't know. And I think it's a problem for ecologists too, how to define ecosystems. But the problem is there because it comes from these general considerations. That would be my answer. But the idea is that possibly there will be invariants in some subfields of biology. I'm doubtful. There are some things that are, some constraints that are shared for a longer time, that are more stable, that are more shared and more stable. But ultimately, there are always cases that exist these things. For example, there was in the 2000s a lot of claims about a new law of nature being the allometry of living beings. Allometry is how, in this case, it's how metabolism relates to size, specifically the mass, we measure the mass, oxygen consumption. And the idea is that there is a regularity that spans a lot of order of magnitude. So for example, in plants, as from the unicellular algae to the baobab. But at the same time, you have a lot of exceptions, and the exceptions in this regularity have meaning. That is to say, it comes from specific evolutionary paths and so on. So it's not an invariant that you can use like in physics.
I asked this question because when I was in engineering, we had some classes which was called applied biology, and there was absolutely everything. Everything related to equation. So for instance, we had, no, that's true, that's all they teach people, they say you can use equation to modelize every possible biology. And for instance, we had population theorization with Volterra Lucta equation and differential equation. And in these equations, it's easy to find some kind of invariant. Once you have a differential equation, you can look for it, you know? But I agree with you, it seems very naive to say these equations are biology, but I think in the mind of people, some field of biology can be reduced to equation. So maybe we need to argue something against them. And another example was the eye. It was a model. I had a complete class about modeling eye movement, saccades, which are micro movements. Mm-hmm. And so it's very related to what you call empiricism, computational empiricism. Yes. Yeah, you know, all was about feedback loop to explain this eye movement. But that was called biology. And so I just wonder if this is that biology, or is that something else? Is there a different way to look at biology? I don't know. So, I was a bit confused.
Yeah, I didn't specify that in my talk, but in a sense, one of my aim is to have a more general and consistent view on biology, in which mathematical models can make sense, but can make more theoretically precise sense. So with the notion of constraints, the aim is really to accommodate, let's say, classical models, but to reinterpret them. I have in mind how quantum physicists reused the classical potentials in their equation, but giving them a completely different meaning, but still reusing them, because you don't work from scratch everywhere. So in a sense, things that work in a way, you have to make justice to the fact that it works in a way, but you have to specify the way in which it works, the limitation and so on. Yes, that's the most part.
First, I would like to thank you for your talk, because I often argue against my colleague there that biology is the creative science and physics is not. And he usually disagrees, but now, with all the arguments you provided me, I won. It's finished now. Okay. But my question more seriously. So how do you see, you know, there's some branches of physics that are more and more historical, more and more specific, cosmology, climatology, but they don't seem to have the same paradigm of modelization than biology. So where do you see the convergence or the divergence between these historical part natural science and geology, and more specific, more and more about historical objects?
Yes. I'm discussing mostly at the level of the structure of theories, okay. Starting from that. And the fact is that, for example, cosmology is a difficult thing for physicists themselves.
Mm-hmm. Because it's not general.
Yeah, there is some kind of history that take place and that is very difficult to address, including it comes also from technical aspects in the theories and so on. And so since I don't know exactly where they are, and it's not my problem in a sense, but I know that there are these challenges, including in physics. Now in biology, there are more specific things that we have, that is to say, the relation, for example, to the notion of function with a double sense that it can have, with Darwinian evolution, genealogy. All those are concepts that can be used to flesh things out a bit more in biology. And then there is the question of geology, provided that geology can be more towards physics when it's not Earth, to our knowledge, and when it's Earth, there is biology involved quite heavily because a lot of Earth dynamic at all time scales, including rock formation, come from biological systems too. So in this case, it's because just
to give you more material, in climatologists just discovered biology recently in the model, and now they include it in the climate model, but they always include it as an external factor or something like that that will perturb or do something on the model, because it seems that it's impossible for them to think as a model with a genealogy in it. It's just, you cannot even think about that. So you have to externalize in a certain sense the creativity of biology in the model.
Yes.
So, but it's going there. I suppose one day they will say, okay, to have a good model, we will have to include more of the creativity of the feedback and all that of life than just putting it as a factor in the differential equation.
But and the same can be said at the human level, because there are different scenarios, for example, for human emissions and so on, and those are in a sense initial conditions or boundary conditions in the models, and so the human part of things is put as external to the understanding of what's going on, whereas the phenomenon is one ultimately. And it would be interesting to have an overarching theoretical perspective to, for example, address things that seem to be sure, for example, at the human level, and things that are more uncertain and so on.
That's a good point, thank you. I have others, but
I've of course, we could talk forever about this. This is really cool, so thanks. The one that I wanted to start with, though, because I think this is probably the most provocative thing I have to say. So I think you're right. I think looking for symmetries and invariance another good way to put the same point is when the nature of the ontology itself is also being molded by the biological processes at work, then yeah, you're not going to have some sort of symmetry coming from space. So I think that's you're spot on, and I love the arguments. But there's another source of stability and structure in physical theory that a lot of people apply in biology that I didn't see here, and that's large numbers and universality in statistics. And so I wonder how that fits into your story, the idea that if we want to tell this story about particular interactions, we're going to have a very hard time looking for biological laws about them. But if we have enough of them, we have populations composed of a large enough number of stuff. Well, that puts us in the same kind of environment as thermodynamics that lets us start to abstract from the behavior of the individual organisms or the behavior of the individual Fisher even did it with genes. I mean, I know that's an outmoded, obviously, good reasons to not do that anymore, but Fisher thought that would work with genes. So I wonder what you think about that as another way in, and how that kind of perspective interacts with the way that you think about what's going on here.
So actually, large number doesn't mean anything. In my framework, it would be a large number with some constraints that is maintained between them. And then it fits in the more general category of things that you can deduce mathematically when some constraints are there. And okay. It's then the interface with reasoning, a bit like in physics. Maybe more investigation would be required to check if everything works well by analyzing things like that. But I would phrase it like that. Now, in practice, in an organism, for example, large number doesn't occur that much, in the sense that even numbers of molecules in a cell, some molecules are in large number, but a lot of them are in very small number, precisely, and it's a source of randomness. And then what happens inside the living beings typically is that there are walls everywhere, so that in a sense, from the point of view of thermodynamician or from the point of view of people from the perspective of statistical physics and so on, it's basically all the conditions that are there for the situation to be bad, to make mathematics. And in a sense, it's kind of logical because it is that enables living beings to change, yeah, and so on. But locally, it can happen that large numbers going towards more generic situation also makes sense biologically. For example, in cells, when proteins are produced at one place in the cell, it is the random motion that bring the molecule to the receptor. So it's a purely anthropic process, but that can be functionalized in a living being. So actually, I thought you would have another question, which is that some constraints are given for free because they come directly from physics principle.
That's another interesting, yeah, idea. Yeah, that's not one that I've played with as much. Yeah, but that's also very cool. Yeah.
But there is that.
Yeah.
And
yeah,
then there are those that come from combinations of constraints and deduction.
Sure. Yeah. No, that's great. That's helpful. Thanks. Yeah, it's really helpful.
Yeah, it's less a question than a comment, because you're very right that most of the time when we see a change of the phase space in physics, it's more of the same. Okay, it's just you open the box and something happens. But there is exception to that, and this is a recent exception, it's quantum fluids. So almost all the last Nobel Prize were all for quantum fluids. And in quantum fluids, physicists are exactly like biologists. It's very funny because they cannot do a model. They just say, there's a change of topological order. You know, it's that kind of bizarre thing that means nothing. And because it's regular, so you pass from some kind of physics to another kind of physics, but there's no reason, no model, nothing to say how you pass from there to there. Here you can modelize, but not between the two. And some Nobel Prize, you know, argue this is pure creation, the physics finally creates something, it has never happened in nature. You go a little bit out of the very framework of physics, like all the potential out here, we can modelize them, just an epistemological question. Now there's creation of new particles, blah, blah, blah. But it's reproducible. So you put the system in the same condition, you will get automatically the same thing. So it's like in your mapping, you know, it's a specific object in the sense that the passage is not the same. It's, it, it's not modelizable. We don't know how you can pass from this to this. But we control the constraint because it's reproducible. So there's not the historical part on the left, but you have completely the center of your graph, and it doesn't look like physics. I have to say that when you read the papers and the journals of the physicists that discover first these quantum fluids and won all Nobel Prize, all of them, was we don't know what is happening, it's completely new, I have no idea what is this. It's pure creation, and sometimes they almost sound like that song, which is not physics. So I'm curious about this. So I should maybe take more attention to your model, because in what part, the historical part on the left, is essential to biology, I suppose, yes. But the creative part in the middle, the fact that you can pass from constraint to constraint in a real change of phase space for me. The creative part, it could be found outside biology, outside historical science, but maybe not the historicity. So in what way, because you connect historicity and closely, let me see, you said variation and historicity. So in what way these two are necessary to coming together, or you can imagine cases where you have variation and without historicity, and it would be not biology, but it would be not physics too.
That's a difficult question. Yeah, I integrate variation and historicity very tightly.
Like in
Maybe to variation by itself is not sufficient to have historicity, and there is a part in which I didn't work enough yet, but it's a question of what could be called memory. And ultimately, it's not just that, but it's reinterpreting DNA and its role in biological systems, so without the notion of program at all, but looking at DNA as constraints, which is reasonable, and it works well. As an example, it works perfectly well, but it's not just any constraints, because it has this role of constraining, for example, development. All along the development, it's a constraint that is there and enables to somewhat reproduce a complex process. But how much it is reproduced, well, it's a big question, but I leave that that's here. So, but for me, these novelties without some kind of randomness or contingency is difficult to think about, because if it's reproducible, once you find some way to give a phase space or something like that, but I don't know this situation, so I'm careful. But you could.
What is weird is that. I'm giving more information for you to have an answer. What is weird is that you have a phase space before, you have a phase space after. It's under control. But you have a reason that we will never find an overreaching theory.
Oh.
Okay, you have, this is why they call it topological order. Because it seems that it's a disruptive, boom, something changed. And if it's not continuous, or if it's, physics is unable to treat that because there's no differential equation. Even quantum mechanics, it's measurement that is a problem, but the evolution is a linear function, so it's under control. So it's these cases that do not map, you know, a phase change or things like that. It's almost discontinuous, but it's still continuous. These are, you know, it's why they use the bizarre world like topological order and things like that, because to show that you cannot, it's unpredictable, it would not be, but it's reproducible, which is strange, because it means that there should be a regularity that you should be able to model.
That's interesting. In my paper on new possibilities, I made several distinctions, notably to block some possibly fallacious argument, which would be, in Bergsonian terms, a retrospective move, that is to say, projecting the future on the past, which is always a way to say that nothing new happens. And to do that, I introduced the notion of actual possibilities, which is almost a contradiction by itself, but it's just this very simple notion that there is my arm here with a muscle and so on. So for example, me going here, the hand here, is an actual possibility because everything is there for it to happen. And it's, in a sense, it's mathematically generated by the constraints that are present now. So this position was an actual possibility even before it happened. And the idea is precisely that new possibilities are not actual possibilities. And
which are your paper you wrote that? This distinction?
Possibility space and the notion of novelty. It was in Synthèse in 2019, I think.
I think I took a photo of that citation.
Oh, okay.
That's cool. I can send the slides if you want. I'm wondering if that would correspond to the situation of the physicist and Gunther, because it's precisely that. You could cheat, maybe, or maybe not, but maybe you could cheat by putting things that are in the end results in the original situation, but things that are not measurable at all, so it will be cheating, really.
Yeah,
maybe there are more contradictions than that.
You cannot do that, that's why it's problematic.
You cannot even do that. Okay.
No, because the future state are forbidden in the laws governing the previous state.
Okay.
So it's why physicists tried all kind of bizarre effective theory, blah, 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 to make sense, because it looks like pure creation. It looks like biology. But it cannot be, because it's reversible.
Yes.
So,
this criterion.
But maybe biology is reproducible. It's just it's very, very, very complicated. I don't know.
Well, these are complicated things that can be reproduced, but then it's more at the level of some constraints. Mm-hmm. There is the case of, for example, the shape of the wolf that is, I don't remember how you say that in English. You had the wolf of Australia and the wolf here that everybody knows that have roughly the same body shape, but they come from different evolutionary paths. So this kind of convergence can be analyzed in terms of constraints if you think that there can be repetition at the level of constraints. What is not repeated is the bulk of the complexity of the organism that is quite different physiology, different systems and so on. But at the level of some constraints, there can be something that can be repeated and let's say articulations of constraints and environmental constraints and so on that can repeat and lead to similar results. Well, the same work for the eye. And it's funny because at the same time the convergence is strong and at the same time the traces of the past are also strong. So for example, in the octopus, the vascular system is below the retina, whereas in your case it's in front, which is not very logical, but that's how it is. And that's traces from the history.
Thank you.
Thank you for your talk. So in the beginning of the talk, you made some parallels between physics and biology in terms of understanding via invariance and variance. So in physics, the idea was that fundamental invariance needs to be explained in biology the other way around, but I had the feeling that you want to keep the parallel or think that invariance as constraint could also be read as fundamental and explanatory. Is that more or less what you...
Yes, the idea is not to get rid completely of the notion of having invariance and so on, because without that, there is no possibility of doing mathematical models. So what I'm proposing is to reinterpret the invariants that are used in mathematical modeling in biology as constraints, and then constraints have different properties than the invariants of physics. So for example, they are
in an organization that sustains them and that they contribute to sustain. And they are taken in this history, which means that they can have an historical origin, they can change. So they have some level of contingency, in a sense.
Okay. So my follow-up question on this is whether you think that is you want to really see that as a reified thing, as something that reflects reality, or rather like a very crude epistemic principle, in the sense that our basic level of explanations, even in folk psychology, to explain somebody's behavior, we always seem to fall back on fixed things, invariants, for instance, somebody's character trait, in combination with varying factors, with the help of which certain character traits we try to explain behavior. This seems like a very crude epistemic principle. While, for instance, in physics, one has the tendency to rather reify these variants, let's say laws or symmetry principles. And I wonder then, is the parallel between biology and physics then rather something superficial in that respect?
I'm not sure about the question, but I will say what is clear is that in physics, the invariants, they are not... they have a deeper meaning. It's not just an ad hoc postulate with respect to a specific question. They get a deeper meaning when they are embedded in a network of mathematical results, empirical results, and so on, that gives them meaning, precisely. Whereas, even in genetics, postulating, for example, the genetic code as an invariant, in a sense, it was just an ad hoc postulate that connected to the emerging information theory and so on. But it was just ad hoc. And actually, if you look at DNA sequence, protein sequence, it's not just a genetic code. So it's just the genetic code corresponds just to a part of the process of protein production. So the invariant is not invariant. The main difference between physics and biology, I think, will be that the invariants structure the theories in physics, and because kind of works on one side, a lot of work is based on it or built on it, they have a very deep meaning, even in theories that are no longer, let's say, at the forefront of what is going on in physics. I mean, for example, classical mechanics, it's overcome in many ways. But at the same time, its mathematical and theoretical structures give a lot of meaning to the invariants that are there, including Noether theorem, for example, that came relatively late with respect to classical mechanics, but deepened its meaning and enabled to interpret some invariants.
Yes. At the level of the structure, when you compare the structure of physics and biology, and when you talk about causality on both, it's a question that I already asked you online, but as was online when we did not have the opportunity to go deep. So, to what extent causality in non-living objects are the same or different from living objects or systems?
That's a complicated question, because causality is not simple by itself already. Already in physics, it's not simple. but actually, there is a similar issue with respect to time. I would say the situation in physics is that causality is addressed through the mathematics, or by the use of mathematics. Or if you want to talk in physics about causality without referring to mathematics, you are in trouble, right? So it gives a specific spin to, let's say, to the causality question.
And in biology, you don't have that. And at the same time, you have something that could be somewhat specific to biology, which is what happens in terms of causality when novel things appear. And that will be a specific kind of causal relationship between the initial situation and after something appeared. That will be different from what's going on in physics. Whatever is going on in physics. And so that's what we called with Giuseppe Longo and Stuart Kaufman enablement. From my point of view, the originality of enablement is precisely for this kind of processes where you have something you cannot at all deduce what will happen from this something because it's really something new. But at the same time, without the initial situation, the new would not appear. So there is something causal about it. And the relationship to what is the process.
Right. But then there you said that there is no entailing loss. So there is no new entailing law that Schrodinger was somehow saying there is an entailing law to understand living systems. And you are saying, no, it's not quite, it's enableable. So it means that in terms of I think in a formal way, how you can phrase this enablement without having an intended causation behind that. Without being entailed some kind of causation.
I would say in practice, well, the simplest answer is to say that it's causations that can be seen retrospectively. At least that's how evolutionists do it. That is to say, you say these bones and this environment led to the emergence of whatever. So retrospectively, you can talk like that. Now, how to frame it exactly and precisely in the with constraints and so on, it's a work in progress.
Yeah?
Yeah, so thanks a lot for a great talk. So, I'd like to, most of the talk was about the structure of theories, and I think you made a very convincing point that the status of the invariances or maybe generalizations is very different in the structure of most theoretical theories compared to, for example, in physics. And you draw some interesting parallels with social sciences and human sciences with the idea that history teaches a role. But my question is, what are the consequences for the topic of scientific explanation? Because so one view is that whatever the status of invariances or generalization, they are the things that do the explanatory work. I understand something when I can put it within the pattern of generalization or invariance. Whether that invariance is like super deep, like in physics, or it's just a local invariance that is tied to a specific like local constraint that is right for a certain system in a certain context and may disappear later. But I understand something when I can like subsume something under a certain kind of invariance. And if this is so, then there's not a big change in terms of how we explain things. It's just that because it still boils down to something under invariances. But so another view is that if I take very seriously the historicity of biological objects and phenomena, it looks like invariances won't explain a lot, because if something changes, I won't understand it by just isolating invariances and subsuming them under invariances. So I guess my question is, how does what you propose fit in the literature on scientific explanation? So do we need to find out a new model of scientific explanation which is more tied to historical phenomena? I know that some like philosophers of historiography have had a hard time trying to find
in the physical science literature, some good models to explain what they are doing when they are explaining historical phenomena. And it strikes me that in cases of biology, where explanations are more mathematically controlled, they are maybe more rigorous than in history books, could be a way to find some insights to this. But okay, I hope my question makes sense.
So again, it's a difficult question. There is an easy answer. It's that in my view, you can always talk about how some constraints articulate to each other. But then, when you have to refer to real biological objects, you have to introduce all the mess with sky and so on. But you can still have reinterpreted, but still kind of classical explanation. But the second kind of answer would be I'm not sure that understanding requires the invariance. I'm not sure of the opposite either. So I'm in doubt, and for now I practice epoche on this one. But it's a very relevant question. It's very close to what I'm working on, but for now I don't have a strong position. And there is the issue of being able to accommodate singular situations scientifically that is behind it. It's a bit everywhere. It's there in history, but it's there in medicine too. It's a big problem, and the bias towards, let's say, statistics, for example, in medicine, can be also counterproductive when not building on also the individuality of the patient. So there is some precise things. Last part in my answer would be that sometimes I'm uncomfortable with the notion of explanation itself. I prefer in French compréhension, that would be understanding, but in French compréhension means taking together, which relates to my initial statements about synthetic work. In a sense, too much focus on explanation itself goes a little bit with computational empiricism, in the sense that explanation can be local, but very, very local and uniquely local, whereas understanding means taking together, so it can be understanding a specific situation, but with respect to evolution, with respect to physics, and so on, so you can have the global in the local, in a sense, with understanding. And so that's why I tend to prefer understanding, and maybe that would lead to raise the question a bit differently. If you don't have to explain, but you have to understand. Maybe the problem is but a bit different.
Okay, many thanks for that. That was great. Yes, I was going to ask something related to the symmetries, but now I want to just ask something about the last part you said, because now I'm a bit confused. I mean, it seems that there are two tendencies that are pulling into opposite directions. One is the idea of understanding, in the sense that, okay, you want to be general, to comprehend the things from a very wide viewpoint. On the other hand, you have the idea of we have to be now specific. I mean, we have working on concrete things and all this discourse. And now to say that this is something more related to knowledge, or no, it's not really understanding. But it seems that the way you phrase the idea of understanding is more or less related to what sometimes physicists do when they try to idealize a system, try to come to get the very general relations that they can get. So the specifics don't matter any longer, because you want to get the whole the main relations. So I probably am confused at some point, but how can you combine these two views? Be specific on the one hand, but other, but on the other, try to get understanding, because it seems that if you want to get understanding, the specifics, you should just abstract away the specifics.
I'm not necessarily say that, because when if you take understanding as doing something like a synthesis, the synthesis does not have to be general. You can, I don't know, address something. You know, even when we talk about development in biology, for example, it seems huge, but at the same time, it's something that appeared in evolution, and usually we focus on mammals, so it's even more specific. And so we are actually working on specific objects, and development in plants is quite different from the one of mammals, for example. So, this matter of specificity is everywhere in biology. That is my point. But it doesn't prevent understanding in the sense of, for example, so development of mammals is specific, but still you have to articulate that to physical forces, to morphogenesis theories, and so on. So I don't think you need to have general invariance to lead to understanding. But then there is another layer to your question, at least to my answer. It's at the level of what I'm doing concretely. So for example, when I showed this thing, by itself, it's not a model, it's a sketch, schemata of things that could be more concrete, but in an application Kai would have to refer to a specific biological object, a concrete one, I mean, ultimately, because names depend on concrete biological objects. So Kai would really be a symbol, and the idea to put symbols to specific objects, not to generic ones, is the way I'm trying to accommodate this contradiction at the level of something that could be a formalism, but not exactly, because there is symbols in it. So it's not genuinely a formalism, but a hybrid construct. And then,
Just one minor point. What do you exactly mean by concrete object? Probably that was confusing to me. I mean, well, at some point you said that in some part of biology we are dealing with concrete objects, but you show, for example, with the video that the word Homo sapiens. For me, Homo sapiens is not a concrete object, it's an abstract object.
No, it's not.
For me, it's a type, it's a kind of. Not like, you know, whatever you want. Okay, for that, my question is, for you, it's a concrete object.
It's not, at least in the standard way to define objects in the classification. In the classification, the name is attached to a specimen, a single specimen. So there is only one specimen with the name Rapus norvegicus or Homo sapiens. I don't remember who it is for Homo sapiens. But I think it's Cuvier, but I'm not entirely sure. You can check afterwards in Wikipedia. But it's always a single specimen. Sometimes there are some tricks. Sometimes it's a drawing because the specimen has been lost or whatever. But basically, it's a single specimen that keeps the name. It's called the name bearer type, more precisely. And then the name is propagated to living beings that are closely related in the analysis, so in the phylogenetic analysis. So it spreads from one single specimen to a group. But the idea in assigning it to a single specimen is then if there is a reconsideration of the group due to some discovery and the group is split, then the single specimen test, well, those are the Rattus norvegicus, and the other one, well, have to be something else, and that's it. So it's a way to organize the classification that justifies how it's attached to a single specimen. But for the strains in laboratories, so those strains, mm-hmm. it's not a single specimen, but it's a single lab. So the idea is that it's more a group, and it's the common ancestor is more a group. And it's a specific lab with an address and so on that is used in the scientific papers to report what has been done. So it's always very concrete material and so on. So it's when I say concrete, it's in a very basic way, that is to say it's this one, this animal here. And it's referred to and it's cataloged and archived. Mm-hmm. But the body is archived.
Mm-hmm. Okay.
So we have 3 minutes. We have to make it very quick.
I just want to push you on your explanation, your notion of explanation. I became very confused because in the talk you were very clear that the principle of sufficient reason do not act the same way. So it's in physics, it's change that you have to explain and not invariance. It's why invariance is the base of explanation. But in biology, constraint has to be explained.
Yes.
So they cannot be the base. The ground of explanation. So after that you said, yeah, but maybe the schema, the sketch could be the thing that explained because that's it's more stable. But now I'm confused.
What can be explained is the persistence of constraints. But
you have to explain persistence of constraint, or persistence can explain something. I'm confused.
No, the persistence of constraints can be explained.
Okay.
But their existence, to an extent, it can be explained or at least retraced. And there we pull back on the question whether retracing is explaining for historical phenomena. To a part, it has some contingents to it. And this contingents is observable in a sense. It's a diversity of living beings. So at this level, there is some indeterminacy or randomness that take place. And yes, that is it for now, I think.
Okay. So it's the history that explains.
I don't use explain much actually.
Yeah, okay.
I use it
point wise. Okay, fair enough.
But what I don't like in explain is that there is an input and output, whereas mm-hmm. I'm working on the framework itself. Mm-hmm. So this framework can generate input and output, but for that, I aim it to be as flexible as possible, but I don't have huge claim on things, except this idea that invariance and especially that persistence can be and should be explained or justified, which is a big difference with physics, and it's a bridge with thermodynamics, closure of constraints, but also natural selection. Yes.
Okay.
So. 5 o'clock on a Friday. So thank you very much to everyone for the